All right, thank you so much. So my name is Bilal Siddiqi. I'm at Dime at the World Bank, and we're doing hoping to do a multi-country study financed by EDI in India, Kenya, and Tanzania. Two caveats, I'm going to focus mostly on India and Kenya because Tanzania is even more preliminary, and also that essentially we just got granted the money, so everything is much less advanced than some of the things that you've seen in previous presentations, but we'll try and keep you entertained. I just wanted to make a shameless plug. This is also part of a program at the World Bank called Data and Evidence for Justice Reform, which has the best part about the program is the acronym. And it essentially tries to take a holistic approach to the justice system, which includes every part of the judiciary, the executive, legislature, and the informal institutions there. There's three broad areas that we're trying to focus on. One is data. Courts have a lot of data, but rarely do people actually look at that data and convert it to information and use the information. And so the idea is really to help courts and judicial systems build up data systems or to actually exploit the information in data systems where data systems do exist. Second part is kind of broadly diagnostics. As kind of you may have seen from Joyce's work and elsewhere, there's a relatively little known about what are the core issues in justice system functioning and performance. And as part of the fact that we would have high frequency data on how cases actually go through court, we could use that both to diagnose what's going on as well as to measure and document the impacts of justice system reforms. And then finally, experimentation, which is hopefully having built up all of this data, use the data itself, the information therein, linking it to incentives, and also work closely with judiciaries and partners to experiment with different kinds of interventions to improve justice systems and try and feed that back into policy. So that's what we're doing, and as part of that, we really have an expanding universe of research questions. And so what you'll see, even in the specific country studies, is we're trying to tackle a bunch of these depending on the context and the opportunity. And the hope is really to build up sort of research programs that can both systematically and opportunistically look at some of these hypotheses. So this is just to frame them, some of the things that keep coming up when we look at this. One kind of broad area is reporting. How do disputes get reported? And specifically interventions such as information through civic education programs, resources through building and upgrading courts, increasing access through legal aid, mobile courts, etc., can affect reporting. The second broad area, of course, is adjudication. How is adjudication, the quality of adjudication, affected by rules like changes in laws, case management practices, procedures, by institutions including specialized courts, small claims, other kinds of litigation alternatives, by the capacity of the judicial officers themselves, how they're hired and trained, by the structure of the courts and the judicial system in terms of the assignment of roles and responsibilities. In addition, of course, incentive systems, asking broadly the questions of what information is actually generated in courts, who receives the information, and what are the kinds of expected responses to that information. Particularly, this is facilitated by the increasing availability of electronic systems, dashboards, e-court systems, so all of this data is increasingly available. And that information can be repurposed and potentially even linked to rewards, such as financial rewards, non-financial rewards, and rewards that activate career concerns or social status, as well as to accountability systems, which could be top-down, peer-based, or bottom-up. And finally, of course, there's preferences and behavior. Judiciaries are impartial and justice is blind, but judges are human beings. They're subject to subjective biases, which might be biased against excluded or vulnerable groups. They may be biased towards in-groups and biased against out-groups. They may be, hypothetically, that happens nowhere, but they may be ideologically biased. Who knows? Behavioral biases, managerial constraints, there's increasing work around that, whether it's questions around inflated expectations, as Joyce pointed out, whether it's through the salience and availability of performance information, cognitive constraints around what to do when you have a lot of things on your plate, time use, etc. So kind of trying to look at all of these, and in that context, I guess I'm going to focus on India and Kenya and give you a sense of kind of some of the opportunities that we're hoping to exploit. So India, 33 million case backlog, that's cases that have been in court for more than 5 years, 12 judges per 1 million people, as opposed to about 3,000 judges in the US. Lots of questions around how minority groups and outgroups are treated, as well as around judicial independence and corruption. There are active and contentious debates going on around court reforms specifically, and kind of standoffs between the judiciary and the executive. And in that broad mess and exciting research environment, as we researchers like to call it, we're partnering with Daksh, which is a civil society organization that is focusing really on data-driven judicial reform. In Kenya, there's a 250,000 case backlog. There's been questions also around, and particularly priorities around judicial efficiency, case management, and the quality of judgments. There's been an ambitious reform program in the last 6 odd years, 8 years maybe, which has been called judiciary transformation, and then sustained judiciary transformation, that has a wide range of priorities and a lot of momentum. And there we're partnering with the judiciary's performance management directorate, under the aegis of a World Bank lending program. All right, research questions in India. One, judicial independence. Specifically, do winning criminal politicians get better judicial outcomes? In other words, is the judiciary actually captured by or influenced by politics? I'll speak about this in a second. And specifically in that context, what are the roles of different agents who could be influencing judicial outcomes, specifically members of legislative assemblies and of political parties? Secondly, bias. Are judges and courts biased against outgroups or against vulnerable populations? And particularly also looking at the hierarchy, if biased judges are supervised by less biased judges or vice versa, does that offset or improve or worsen the judicial outcome? In terms of behavior and management, we're looking at whether simple nudges can improve judge time, use, and performance. Well, I wanted to call this proposal Nudges for Judges, but I was told that that was a terrible idea. So some of the things that we've been talking about that Daksh is considering, they've got a mobile app that's already been rolled out across 26 courts in Delhi and potentially being scaled up. And the app provides a lot of opportunities to conduct RCTs on using auto-scheduled hearings, time use of judges, performance information, etc. So we're still exploring the options of doing RCTs there. And we particularly also want to see if gains in judicial productivity come at the expense of quality. Incentives. There's a very kind of interesting, arbitrarily designed in some cases, and highly variable point system that varies by state and high court, that rewards judges. So particularly case weighting system that maybe for a murder case, you might get 20 points if you adjudicate a murder case, whereas you might get 1 point if you adjudicate a driving or disorderly arrest type case. And so judges obviously respond to these particular points by taking certain cases, leaving certain cases, keeping cases in their dockets. And the point is that the performance systems, A, vary a lot across space and administrative system, and secondly, are in dire need also of reform and rationalization. And so another kind of context in which we're hoping to make some progress potentially is working with states to improve their performance point system, and then seeing whether that changes, to what extent that changes the way that judicial decisions are made. Finally, in terms of access, we want to just exploit the fact that there's 22,000 courts in India, and courts are vacant, and then the vacancies are filled, and so on. So there's a lot of exogenous shocks to judicial access. So we're thinking about various kinds of quality quasi-experimental methods, event studies, etc., that could be used to see whether exogenous shocks to judicial access actually improve or affect the market for justice, and particularly the mechanisms through which that happens, specifically institutional competition, forum shopping, etc. The data is super rich. Daksh has a database of 14 million cases from end to end that they've scraped off of the eCourts database out of a total population of maybe about 40 million cases that are in the eCourts database. These cases correspond to 62 million hearings. We have this data somewhere in my laptop. There's a random sample. The data has been extracted as a random sample of data from the eCourts database, so it's representative. And there's structured metadata on courts, dates, parties, case types, and judges. That's not all. There's separately in India, there's IndianKanoon.org, which basically records 2.25 million high court judgments, along with the entire published text of these judgments. So we have Well, they have more. We have about 2.25 so far. We're still scraping. And we have about coverage of 21 out of 24 high courts and over an 81-year period. So what we are, and again, there's a lot of information there, including identities of people, et cetera. And then we're combining that with what I call Sam Asher's job market paper, which is all the metadata in the world in India. And specifically that microdata from the socioeconomic caste census and economic censuses from sort of politician data from the Association for Democratic Reform, and caste and names and identities from anthropological survey data. I don't know, he's done a lot of work in his time there. So, I'm just going to talk about one or two of these super quickly. Our judiciary is independent. 30% of politicians in India have a criminal case being filed against them. This is a comparison of politicians in India, MPs, who have a case, the proportion of MPs who have a case filed against them of each type versus the general population. I really love that graph. And so basically we're going to be using the Dutch data and a kind of a close election regression discontinuity approach to basically see if in closely competitive elections, whether the winning criminal politician gets better judicial outcomes than the losing criminal politician. Our judge is biased. Here we are basically we're working with Daniel Chen and Elliot Ash, who have done a lot of textual analysis of US-based data, specifically looking at the analysis of sentiments. Specifically, do judges use specific words or adjectives in referring to members of certain population groups, and to what extent can we relate those to real-world outcomes? And doing a fair amount of sentiment analysis using Python and various coding opportunities. This is an example of this. So Hindu defendants tend to be informal, prejudiced, and honest, but also retiring. Muslim defendants tend to be pleasant, handsome, outgoing, but also greedy. Scheduled caste defendants happen to be obnoxious, coarse, organized, and thorough, and also nervous, perhaps rightly. And so that's what we're getting from our initial database. This is now mapping the judge identity to the defendant identity, so now you can start to see interesting, even more interesting patterns. The red in each of these is bad and green is good, so there's more red for scheduled caste defendants roughly. There's a lot more green for co-affiliates, and so that's kind of what's interesting there. So that's where we're going. I'm going to take the leeway of one additional minute to rapidly run through Kenya. Because we have a lot going on in Kenya as well. Kenya, we're basically doing the beginning of an RCT that basically compares the role of actionable information, which is information that is actually linked to direct actions that judges can take to improve their performance, looking there at whether that can improve judicial productivity without reducing judicial quality. We're also going to be layering that with accountability, specifically bottom-up accountability from court user committees, which includes prosecutors, but also community representatives and so on, and to what extent that it can improve end user service satisfaction. We're also in the process of now starting engaging with the court annex mediation or ADR systems there, specifically can they affect decongest courts, and looking at ways of improving active case management, which is a huge priority for the Chief Justice right now, specifically how do we streamline the case management process. There's a lot of data that we've been really spending most of our time mapping, sources, how to measure efficiency, quality, and access. And finally, here's the example of the one-pager that's going to be launched in the next few weeks / couple of months, which basically tells each judge on a monthly basis how they've been doing on the various kinds of decisions and so on, what are the top three reasons for high levels of adjournments in this particular case, and what the benefit would be if they tackled each of those reasons in terms of their case clearance rate, which is a heavily incentivized outcome. So you can see that each of these reasons, if tackled, basically gives, it's just a vertical shift of the performance line, and so you are incentivizing judges, giving them very clear ideas about what they need to be doing. In the background, there's a bunch of regressions being run to extrapolate what these effects would be, and we're hoping that gives them more than just a name and shame, but actually gives them things to do to respond to. We're doing a randomized controlled trial across all 126 court stations in Kenya, so it's at scale. The first treatment is going to be this. a second treatment is going to be this plus a quarterly deliberative meeting with the court user committees, and then the controls will be no change. So that's where we are. Thank you.
Maybe a question?
Yes.
Thanks. This is great. You identified that there was examination of various identities. I'm assuming gender was one of them. So there is data. What were some of the findings? Was gender a mediating factor for better results or for worse results? Also, how were you able to extract data on gender? Because we found it very difficult.
Right, so maybe big picture, we have, so those were literally things that came to me on my Slack channel a couple of days ago. So this is very, very early, and one of the things we focused on, because there, the unusual thing is that we do have these socioeconomic census and caste names and social group names, which Harish was telling me are extremely noisy, and I agree, but they give us a good sense. So we really wanted to see if that would work. As a result, we haven't done the simpler things yet, like gender disaggregation and gender bias, but it's going to be trivial to do it now that the data is kind of set up. Extracting the information on gender, as we have with caste, has really been coming from, certainly the caste has been coming from names, but gender of the litigants and gender of the judges is actually recorded in the case and administrative data. I don't know how, I have strong suspicions how, but I don't know exactly how things, it works here, but as an example, in the US case, from their similar work there, you find very strong biases against women in judicial decisions, but actually reasonably positive biases towards them in terms of how they're defined. And this kind of goes to the point I was making yesterday about how you have to be a bad male in order to get punished, but you can be any kind of female and you'll get punished. That's basically, the problem. One of the many problems.
How do you deal with the endogeneity of investigations being biased versus the judiciary being biased in the criminal politician data?
Great question. So at this point, all we've done is, we haven't gone that far. So what we've simply done right now is said, okay, here are politicians that have been accused of and have an FIR registered against them. Now when the politician chooses, or when any individual chooses to run for office, in the affidavit they have to basically supply to the federal government all of the FIRs they currently have that are against them. And all we're doing is, you may or may not be the effective, you may or may not have a real case against you, but do we on average see narrowly winning politicians? So that's, I think, the key, is that you're still identifying people who on the margins could have won. How do their outcomes get affected by the judicial process? So I think it really does rely on the identification strategy, and I can totally see why over particularly a repeated play, like investigations would be super endogenous, though potentially equally so. We're also hoping at some level that there's two ways of getting at the potential mechanisms for bias. So one is through these MLAs, the other is through party control in the state, and both of those, because there's different accountability systems, different things that each of those institutions have have under their purview, we could potentially separate out, for example, the extent to which the police are actively promoting a particular political end, which would be much more likely if they were party control versus if they were MLA control, and so on. I would also love to learn a little bit more about the Indian judicial system, having only lived in terror of it as a Pakistani.
So we're going to move on. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.